Every time you in the news, it's because you getting at somebody. Where's your music? You know, put your music out, and when I see your name on Billboard, that's when I'll respond to you. Other than that, goodbye.
You just stole my style and just run with it, and then, you know, you just throwing shots at me. That's not how it goes, because I'll be damn if I'm just lay down. I'm not dead.
What up, guys? Your boy Quake, and I'm finally back with a brand new episode of Who Really Won. And a lot of you have been requesting me to do a female battle MC that happened between females, and finally, I'm giving that to you guys. I didn't even notice that I didn't have a female battle on the Who Really Won series yet. I was looking over a lot of battles that females had in the history of hip-hop and decided to go with Nicki Minaj versus Lil' Kim, Who Really Won. And the reason why is because Nicki Minaj has been having a lot of issues with Cardi B, and I decided this is the perfect time to talk about her past issues with artists. And there has been a lot of speculation on if Nicki Minaj has paid homage to the previous female MCs that came before her, and this video will clarify a lot of that as well. And you'll notice throughout the video there is a lot of comparisons between Nicki Minaj and Lil' Kim, because there aren't really a lot of female MCs that you can take from that people won't notice, because there hasn't been that many MCs. For example, if a male rapper takes something from a few male rappers, you won't really notice it because there's so many male rappers. And with that being said, let's get into it. You know how we do this if you've seen this series. The first thing we do is we talk about how the beef started. I'll talk about Lil' Kim's side of the story, and then I'll talk about Nicki Minaj's side of the story on how it started. Then we talk about the major points in the beef. Then I'll talk about who won the battle portion of the beef, which is in the midst of the battle, who won it, who is releasing the better music, who is going harder. And then I'll talk about the war portion of the beef, who won after the beef was over, longevity, who had a better career after. So grab a drink, grab some popcorn, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. First, let's talk about Lil' Kim's side of the story, and this one is quite interesting. Lil' Kim has said in various interviews that she's been paying attention to Nicki Minaj before she really blew up, and I'm talking like early 2000s, like 2004, 2005, because Nicki Minaj was making music in the early 2000s, but didn't really blow up till 2009/2010. And when Lil' Kim was paying attention to Nicki Minaj, she felt like Nicki Minaj was sending subliminal shots towards her. And if you know Lil' Kim, you know she calls herself the Queen Bee of hip-hop. And in various tracks, Nicki Minaj would send shots saying stuff like, "I'm going to snatch the crown from the queen of hip-hop," and just various stuff like that.
You don't have a winning town, check the roster, girl. I'm coming for the crown, Kim, that's the word. I'm coming for these rap bitches if they ready or not. You know the girl ain't ready to hot. You tell them fuck a new bitch, I want a veteran spot. Look.
Fit it down and I'm ready to play. When your album gon' drop, bitches never could say fuck I look like giving birds they props. Bitches act like they hot, but I heard they not. How the fuck you in the game like 10 years strong? Y'all bitches still can't write your own damn song?
I always kept my ear to the streets. I'm always on the internet. I saw her coming up. Mm-hmm. I saw her making her way. I watch everything. I know everything that's going on.
Really?
Yeah, I saw her coming up. And I saw her coming in the game like, all you chicks that been in the game for 10 years, you know, move over. Y'all need to sit down and this and that. I thought that was disrespectful.
And in a lot of interviews, Nicki Minaj would mention the same thing, but Lil' Kim brushed it off. She said, you know, she's an upcoming artist. She has to be confident. You know, it doesn't matter as long as it's not direct shots at her. She didn't really care. Lil' Kim would also notice Nicki Minaj copying her style, copying some of her lyrics, copying some of her looks and her fashion. But once again, Lil' Kim was like, let her come up. It doesn't matter. You know, she's going to have her shine as long as she pays homage. Fast forward to 2009, and Lil' Kim is having talks with Slim, who's Birdman's brother, about signing to Cash Money Records. And ironically, around that time, Nicki Minaj met Lil Wayne and signed to Young Money / Cash Money Records. After the meeting, Birdman called Lil' Kim and asked her to appear on a track that he was planning on having as a single and shooting a music video for. After Lil' Kim recorded her verse and turned it in, Birdman a few days later called her and asked her if it was okay to have Nicki Minaj on the same track as her. And Lil' Kim was fine with that. She said it's a good thing for females in hip-hop to collaborate, and hopefully they'll shoot a music video for it, and so on. The song was called Grinding Making Money, and Birdman decided to put it on iTunes. And when it was on iTunes, a lot of people apparently in the feedback, according to Lil' Kim, were saying that Lil' Kim's verse was way harder than Nicki Minaj's. And after that, Birdman apparently removed the song off of iTunes in fear that people would like Lil' Kim over Nicki Minaj and that Nicki Minaj wouldn't be able to blow up. And of course, this is all according to Lil' Kim. None of this is 100% official. This is Lil' Kim's side of the story.
You know, if people do their homework, I did a song with her and Baby.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be for Baby's album, okay? And he never put it on the album that originally went out, the one that, you know, was the first CD.
He told me about the song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so he never put it on there. And one of the main reasons being is because after they had put it on iTunes, a lot of people were like, oh, Kim killed it, Kim this, Kim that, which I guess kind of overshadowed her. And my thing is, hey, you know what I mean? You're gonna get that in the industry, you know, just, you know, keep going, whatever, do you. And for a lot of people who don't know, I was over in the presence of Cash Money. You see how we chilling?
Yeah.
I used to chill with them the same way. The same way, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I never, unfortunately, got to run into her over there, but I ran into Wayne a couple times. I was always there with Baby and Slim and a couple of other guys from the group. So basically what I'm saying is we were going to be alliances. I was going to be a part of that family. Slim and I were talking about some business ventures we were going to do together. I'd known Slim for about 4 years,
mm-hmm.
and we were friends for about 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And during those 4 years, which was like right after I came home from prison mainly, we talked about doing some like a business venture together where they would kind of be my partners.
Mm-hmm.
And so think about it. It has to be deeper than just paying homage.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm over there, if I'm in your circle, I'm not going to come over there and start trouble with one of your people.
And when the song was removed off iTunes and they never shot a music video for it, Lil' Kim felt disrespected, felt like Nicki Minaj had a role in her not having a music video shoot for it and the song being removed off iTunes. And she felt like Birdman and Slim used her when they had a meeting. They copied her style and gave the blueprint to Nicki Minaj so she could take Lil' Kim's style, Lil' Kim's rhyming ability, and basically use it on her own tracks. And the way Lil' Kim proves this is that when Nicki Minaj first got into music, she was more hardcore. Her lyrics were more aggressive. She wasn't the Barbie image that she has now. And Lil' Kim says that when she finally did the meeting with Birdman and Slim, they took all of her blueprint, her ideas, her Barbie image, all that stuff that Lil' Kim did previously, and basically implemented it to Nicki Minaj.
You know what I mean? I came over here because I saw that they were trying to take her in a direction to kind of, you know, swagger-jack me, which is okay if, you know, you're gonna acknowledge the fact and also, you know, not be throwing shots. She was throwing shots and, you know what I'm saying? I saw her out one time, didn't say anything to me.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't understand that. And then, you know, still throwing shots in the media, on songs, you know, in interviews. I didn't get that part of it. And I even told Baby and Slim, I was like, look, you know what I'm saying? Just, you know, let home girl know it's okay. You know, she don't gotta be throwing shots. And Slim was like, yeah, oh, I'm gonna make sure that ain't happening no more. Okay, fine. But it kept going. Just to let her know, it's okay, mama. You don't have to keep going the route that you think you need to go, the route that you're going. You know what I mean? But sometimes when females come into this industry, they don't have anybody in their ear like that. They have people in their ear like Baby saying, you know, you need to be the only one out there. You know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
anything else is going to take away from you. We need to get you hot first. That's not how it goes, because I'll be damned if I'm just lay down. I'm not dead. They're like, what the heck? I don't get that.
And that's how the beef started, according to Lil' Kim's point of view. Now let's talk about Nicki Minaj's point of view on how the beef started. And to her, when they first met backstage in 2009 at a Lil Wayne concert, she said everything was cordial with Lil Kim. They took a picture together, and Nicki Minaj asked Lil Kim, "Is everything fine between us?" And Lil Kim apparently said, "Yes, everything is good." However, as time went on, according to Nicki Minaj, Lil Kim would do various interviews and say that Nicki Minaj isn't paying homage and that she's stealing her image. And that's according to Nicki Minaj when the beef officially started with her.
I remember I saw her on the tour with Wayne. And I had been hearing, you know, back, you know, in the business, people talk behind the scenes. Mm-hmm. And I remember I ran into Foxy, and Foxy said, "Why you keep on giving props to Kim? She don't like you." She was like, "The girl be dissing you, like when, you know, in conversation." And I said, I'm so much of a, like, oh, diehard. I was like, until I hear her say something about me, I'm going to continue paying my respect to her in my interviews. And that's what I did. I kept on doing it. That's why everybody came out and said, "Nicki always shows you love. Like, what are you talking about?" So when I saw her at Wayne's concert, she performed with Keisha. She came into our dressing room. She went and used the bathroom and stuff. And I stopped her. I was like, you know, I want to make sure everything is cool with us because I'm a fan first, you know. Is everything good? Yeah, everything good. We good. Hugs and kisses. Can I take a picture with you? I love you, you know. This is somebody that I looked at highly. We took a picture. Everything was good. I respect you. I love you. I've said it in every interview, time and time again. And if that's not good enough with you, mama, then it's something deep-rooted in you. You need to get your... Something is bothering you inside. That's your insecurity bothering you. It's not Nicki Minaj. It would have been any girl that started popping.
But when it was officially public was in June 2010. In early June 2010, Ray J and Lil' Kim performed together. And when they performed together, Ray J essentially called out Nicki Minaj and said that she's an imposter and that he doesn't like that in hip hop. She needs to find her own image. And of course, Lil Kim agreed with him. And after this is when the beef officially was public. People started to notice Nicki Minaj and Lil Kim didn't like each other. I'm going to play the clip of Ray J calling out Nicki Minaj and Lil Kim agreeing, but I warn you, the audio is very, very terrible. I'm sorry I couldn't find a better video with better audio. It's just very loud and it's very hard to hear Ray J, so I apologize in advance.
But I've been seeing a lot of imitators, a lot of imposters trying to do what Kim do. You know what I'm saying? And I'm a little bit irritated by the shit because I'm like, straight up, Kim is the best female rapper in the game. And I don't give a fuck. Why the fuck is trying to dive the style? You know what I'm saying?
I swear I love y'all.
Why the fuck is trying to wear, you know what I'm saying, wear the clothes, wear the wigs?
After that, literally 24 hours later, Nicki Minaj was performing and she brought out Drake. And when she brought out Drake, Drake made it very clear that he does not like what Lil' Kim has said about Nicki Minaj.
So I just want to say that you the baddest woman to ever do this rap shit. I just want to say I don't give a fuck what Lil' Kim or nobody else talking about. You the baddest chick to ever do this shit.
I just feel like Lil Kim is a G in the game, you know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like, you know, you're part of an era that's classic that we'll never forget as young kids, you know, me and Nick. So it's like, you don't have to do that. You don't have to get on stage and announce your presence or tell people to pay homage. Like, that's a given, you know? And I've watched Nicki pay homage to her time and time again. I just didn't respect it at all. Whoever else was on stage with her, I don't respect that. Like, it's like... you're just wearing your heart on your sleeve, like you're showing that you're upset, you know what I'm saying? And to me, like, nobody's done that to me yet, you know? Mm-hmm. But I would never expect like Jay or Ye to get on stage and be like, "Yo, pay homage to me, that's all I, you need to respect me." They know, they command my respect with right. Their music and talent, you know? And I feel like that's just signs that you're just losing it, like, mm-hmm. You know? I mean, that's just how I felt. I really did take that personally, like, it bothered me. And I really don't get too much caught up in like the Twitter, right. Internet stuff, but I did see it, and I just was like, man, you're supposed to be a G, and that's like, that just wasn't G to me at all.
After this, thisis50.com got an exclusive interview with Lil' Kim, and she clarified everything and even took a lot of shots at Drake, who was upset with Diddy for the fact that Diddy is now starting to work with Nicki Minaj a lot more, and Lil' Kim and Diddy have had a long relationship since the 90s.
And on top of all that, y'all ain't want to rock with me? It ain't got nothing to do about no fucking how long a person been in this industry or how long. I don't know what the fuck that punk pussy Drake talking about. Because at the end of the day, this nigga showed his, he bore his heart on his sleeve. He showed his fucking true colors by coming at me, and I'm a fucking girl. You know what I mean? Ray J is the one who said everything. You ain't mentioned this nigga name not one time. But it's okay, because I'm going to ride with my people. Ray J said this shit out of love for me. And that's right, I'm a vibe with it.
This is
50. But at the end of the day, nigga, you coming at me and I'm a female, you let me know that damn you stand me like you stand 50 J or one of them. You right, put right. me in that category, thank you. Puppy should be ashamed of himself. I had to spank
this
him.
This is 50.com.
He should be ashamed of himself. That's just about, that's how I feel. You know, I don't feel no other way, but he should be ashamed of himself. Because when I came home from jail, there was nothing Puffy couldn't ask me to do. Whatever he asked me to do, I was there. Kim, I need you for BET. Can you perform with me? No problem, I'm there. Kim, I need you on this remix. Can you do this? No problem, I'm there. Kim, it's Justin's birthday party. Oh, no problem, I'm there. That's my baby.
Then a few weeks later, towards the end of June, Diddy released the official remix to Hello Good Morning, which featured Nicki Minaj, and in the beginning of her verse, she sends subliminal shots at Lil' Kim.
I just came up in it, a little bit self-centered, but did I kill a queen, the Alexander McQueen?
And during the month of June, Lil' Kim did a lot of shows, and while she was doing shows, she made it very clear that she did not like Nicki Minaj and that she copied her style. She even wore a pink wig just to say that, hey, this is my style. I created this. Nicki Minaj is just taking it.
I'm such a fucking trendsetter.
In that same month, Nicki Minaj did a crazy thing, and she got D-Rock, who used to manage Lil' Kim before she got locked up, to be on Nicki Minaj's team. She tweeted, "Welcome aboard, D-Rock," with a picture of him and her. As months went on, Lil' Kim kept doing shows and kept taking shots at Nicki Minaj. Then finally, in October 2010, Nicki Minaj appeared on Kanye West's Monster track, and she sent some subliminal shots at her. In the same month of October, Nicki Minaj released the song called Roman's Revenge featuring Eminem. And on this song, there were some insane subliminal shots going at Lil' Kim. Even though Nicki Minaj denies the song is about Lil' Kim, it's very clear that some of the lines are directed at her.
Look at my show footage, how these girls be spazzing. The fuck I look like getting back to a has-been. Yeah, I said it, has-been. Hang it up, flat screen. You play the back, bitch, I'm in the front. You need a job, this ain't cutting it. Nicki Minaj is who you ain't fucking with. You little fragabot beat you with a padlock. I am a movie, camera block. You out of work, I know it's tough, but enough is enough.
And while doing the promo run for her debut album, Pink Friday, she sat down with Angie Martinez on Hot 97 to talk about her beef and issues with Lil' Kim. She says that Lil' Kim is just simply a sore loser and that she's jealous that Nicki Minaj has now become the number one female artist. Nicki also said that Lil' Kim needs to release new music because she hasn't had a Billboard hit in so long and that she won't respond to Lil' Kim unless she has a Billboard hit. Lil' Kim then heard that and pulled up to Nicki Minaj's hood in Queens and decided to perform there. And when she performed there, she made it clear that she doesn't need another hit and that she has various classics that Nicki Minaj will never have.
I'm fucking here! Right now, I kill that bitch with my own shit, drop it!
Then Nicki Minaj finally released her debut album on November 19th, 2010, and in this week, Lil' Kim randomly decided to drop a diss song called Black Friday, which of course was response to her album Pink Friday, and took direct shots at Nicki Minaj.
Who the fuck want war? FedEx me straight to your front door. It'll be a murder scene. I'm turning Pink Friday to Friday the 13th. Aight, you little Kim clone clown. All this buffoonery, the shit stops now. Time for you to lay down. I'm sick of the fraud. I put hands on this bitch like a spa massage. Yeah. This hood shit you and Drake ain't built for. This the shit the other bitch almost got killed for. See, the fact is, what you doing, I did it. Lame trying to clone my style and run with it. That's cool, I was the first one with it. You's a little Kim wannabe, you just hate to admit it.
After that, the following month in December 2010, Lil' Kim stopped by Hot 97's Angie Martinez's show, and Angie asked how could this beef possibly be squashed, and Lil' Kim said that Nicki Minaj would have to pay a lot of money for her to squash this beef.
Damn, I would do a song with her.
You would?
For the right price.
Oh my God.
She's a hustler.
$7 million.
Following that, in January 2011, the artwork for Lil' Kim's Black Friday mixtape leaked. And on the artwork, it's clear that Lil' Kim has chopped off Nicki Minaj's head from the Pink Friday artwork. And after that artwork leaked on February 14th, 2011, Lil' Kim dropped her mixtape called Black Friday, and a few tracks on there are going directly at Nicki Minaj.
All these bitches is my pets. I keep a tight leash around their necks. Bitches try to bite, take their ass to the vet. Put them right to sleep like they popped Xanax. All you clones had your shine like cubic stones. Now the show is over, Jenny Jones. Toss him in the lake like Ricky, bitch. And I stay on this money like a pyramid.
Following the release of the Black Friday mixtape, Lil' Kim decided to go to Twitter and said, "Thank you guys. Lil' Kim Black Friday mixtape sold 113,000 copies in 28 hours, which made me the number one seller on PayPal ever. Thank you." So Lil' Kim was claiming that she sold 113,000 copies of her mixtape, apparently for $7.99 via PayPal. Although this wasn't proven, this wasn't confirmed by anyone. It was just Lil' Kim tweeting it out. Of course, Nicki Minaj responded on Twitter and basically just laughed her ass off with this tweet. Following that, a few days later, Lil' Kim dropped the music video for the title track off the Black Friday mixtape. And in the music video, it featured Nicki Minaj's ex-manager, Fendi. And of course, this was just to get back at Nicki Minaj for involving Lil' Kim's ex-manager back in 2010 of June. Following that, in March of 2011, Lil' Kim stopped by MTV's Rap Fix and clarified why she dropped the Black Friday mixtape. Then in early April of 2011, a new song leaked online. The song was from Nicki Minaj and it was called Tragedy. And on the song, she's taking clear shots at Lil' Kim.
Pink Friday, Eminem, 8 Mile. It must hurt to sell your album or PayPal. Especially when you win the game 15-20. You was hot when Shaq teamed up with Penny. Man, you was magic. I mean, look at you now, ho. You're just tragic.
Following that, most of the beef had died down, but on September 20th, 2011, Birdman released a song called Why You Mad, and on Nicki Minaj's verse, it's clear she's going at Lil' Kim once again.
This pussy clean, this pussy squeaky, that pussy on, that pussy creaky, damn, billboard, I mean I'm winning but I'm still bored, yeah we shine, gold cluster, as for your career, dead. Ghostbuster.
Following that, Lil' Kim decided to respond with a freestyle over Uncle Murder's Warning instrumental, and on November 9th, 2011, she released that freestyle, and she's going at Nicki Minaj, Lil Wayne, and Birdman.
I ain't playing, ooh, I ain't stopping, this bitch still throwing shots, ooh, let's get it popping, I'm a real voice, bitch, ooh, Gazelle the Blanco got the best blow in town, ooh, the head honcho, this Lil' Kim clone. She looked stupid. I'm niggas rapping like baby. Ooh, that mean they trash. I'm just saying. The game is full of fraud. Me and Wayne got on the same jeans. Ooh, something wrong.
Following that, Nicki Minaj released a new single on December 20th, 2011 called Stupid Ho, and a lot of people were saying these are shots directly at Lil' Kim. I get it cracking like a bad bag. Bitch talking, she the queen when she looking like a lab rat. I'm Angelina, you Jennifer. Come on, bitch, you see where Brad at. Ayo, SB, what the fuck's good? We should platinum, them bitches is shipping wood. Lil' Kim responded by appearing on a Bravo TV show called Watch What Happens Live, and on there she said if Nicki Minaj made a song called Stupid Ho, then she must be the stupid ho.
I'm pretty sure I feel the same way everybody else feels right about now. All right. You know, all right. If you have to make a song called Stupid Ho, you must be the stupid ho.
Makes sense.
Fast forward a few months later, on April 2012, Nicki Minaj stopped by the Breakfast Club and talked a little bit about her beef with Lil' Kim.
We went at it.
Mm-hmm.
The best woman won, and I'm ready to move on. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not that people make it a bigger deal than I make it. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Like.
Then the following month, Lil' Kim stopped by the Breakfast Club as well and talked about her beef with Nicki Minaj.
Every single record she's made was coming at me. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you say. I don't care what you say. I don't care what nobody say. Everybody who's smart with a brain, everybody who knows music knows damn well in that Puffy record she was coming at me. I didn't say nothing about this chick. I didn't say nothing about this chick at this time. She was coming at me in the Puffy record. She was coming at me in all these records that she was doing, the Jay and Kanye rest. I didn't say nothing. So what is all, I don't understand where all this is coming.
How come women?
Following that, the beef between Lil' Kim and Nicki Minaj had died down significantly. And for the rest of 2012, not much was said besides in the summer of 2012, Lil' Kim sent a few shots at Nicki Minaj on Twitter. But other than that, 2012, the beef did not reignite anymore. In 2013, that whole year went by and no beef between Nicki Minaj and Lil' Kim was happening. Of course, Nicki was focusing on her music. Lil' Kim ended up having a child, so they were both focused on different things. However, in 2013, when Nicki Minaj was doing an interview with Hot 97, she said that she was over the beef with Lil' Kim and that she's focused on herself and just having positive vibes.
Yes, I don't have beef with anybody. Let me just say that too. Life is too short. It's not even as, nothing is ever that serious. Like, not with you, not with other artists, nobody.
Not.
Then 2014 came and the beef got reignited. And in early August 2014, Beyonce released the remix to her single called Flawless. And on her remix, she had Nicki Minaj. And in Nicki Minaj's verse, she says that she's rapping with the Queen Bee. And of course, a lot of people call Beyonce the Queen Bee as well as Lil' Kim. So Lil' Kim did not know at the time or didn't really care and took that as shots at her. A few days later passed and Lil' Kim decided to jump on Beyonce's Flawless remix, replaced Nicki Minaj's verse, and even replaced her face on the cover art and decided to diss Nicki Minaj.
Am I tripping on this hoe just say my name? Queen of rap, fuck you out of here. Queen is back, fuck you out of here. Time to get this rap bitch up out of here. These bitches got me on my bully, yo. Look at the shit, still got my dick on the lips. I ain't been stuntin' a bitch, damn it's a shame. I gave you the rope, bitch, I want you to hang.
Following that, a few days later, Lil' Kim released another diss track called Identity Theft.
I ain't got time for bum bitches, the gun kidded, I come with it. Anything you try to do, I done did it. I let you live for a while, but I'm done with the crown of queens back, bitches, come get it.
Following these two disses, a lot of people expected this beef to be reignited, but Nicki Minaj never responded to both of these tracks. She just kept it moving. A few years later passed, and Remy Ma and Nicki Minaj were having their own beef, and when Lil' Kim was asked about it, she said she wouldn't get involved and that Remy Ma could handle Nicki Minaj on her own. Later that year in 2017, Lil' Kim stopped by Hot 97 and talked about Nicki Minaj briefly saying that she's a snake.
A snake is a snake. I'm not going to pick it up just because, all right, it was being nice to me, wrapping around my leg. It's still a snake, you know what I mean, at the end of the day. So that situation, it would have to probably be a business move and conversation. For real.
And that's it for this story of who really won. This was Nicki Minaj versus Lil' Kim. As you can see now, Nicki Minaj is having issues with Cardi B. Lil' Kim has moved on. She's working on her documentary and various other things. Now let's talk about who won the battle portion of the beef. in the midst of the beef while it was going down, who had the better music, who had the better responses, and so on and so forth. I'd have to give the battle portion to Lil' Kim because she released a lot more diss tracks. She even shot music videos for those diss tracks, and she just focused more time on Nicki Minaj. Even though that incident with the PayPal thing of her selling 113,000 copies or something was never proven and it kind of looked a little bit corny, it's still, her diss tracks were way better. Nicki Minaj only had like one actual diss track going at her, which was that Tragedy track. And on the rest, she was just sending a bunch of subliminal shots here and there. Plus, Lil' Kim had a lot of proof in what she was saying with the copying the image of her. Nicki Minaj was copying her style, copying her bars, and stuff like that. She was proving it when she was saying that. I can see why people would say Nicki Minaj won the battle, because Nicki Minaj was sending subliminal shots and having a lot of hit records at that time. She was having number ones, number one albums, selling a lot of copies, selling a lot of singles. So she was definitely dominating. But if you look at the diss tracks, if you look at the responses, it seems like Nicki Minaj really didn't care. And she, you know, she doesn't have to care, because Lil' Kim really at that time really wasn't popping like Nicki Minaj was. So the Nicki Minaj argument I can see, but I still give it to Lil' Kim for the battle portion. Now let's talk about the war portion of the beef, which is longevity after the beef. What happened? Did their career excel? Did it decline? And this one is pretty simple. I give this clearly to Nicki Minaj. I mean, after the beef, it didn't really affect her. People kept buying her music. She just kept rising and rising, having number one albums, selling singles that were like 5, 6, 7 times platinum. And Lil' Kim really didn't do much. She tried to release some mixtapes and it didn't really go well for her. She didn't get back in the spotlight. She had been saying that she's been releasing her next album and it hasn't been released yet. And of course, besides the music, Nicki Minaj has had a lot of brand endorsements, from Pepsi to like Macy's to a bunch of other stuff. And like I said, Lil' Kim hasn't really been back in the spotlight in a really long time. So it's clear Nicki Minaj won the war portion of this beef. But overall, both of these female MCs are dope. They both had their moments. They both had their dope albums or singles where they were rising and doing great and releasing just great music overall. But that's it for this episode of Who Really Won, Nicki Minaj versus Lil' Kim. Leave a comment below. Let me know what you guys think. Who won the war portion? Who won the battle portion? And what video you guys want me to do next? So with that being said, if you want to support this channel further, you can do so at patreon.com/diversementality. A link is in the description below. For just $1 a month or more, you can support this channel further. Like, comment, share, and definitely subscribe. I do videos like this daily on hip-hop news and much, much more. So definitely subscribe. Follow me on Twitter and on Instagram @QuakeGW. Like us on Facebook, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace.